flatbed idea in 2014. I watched one video that basically someone said that if the earth's a ball, why then upside down in Australia? Something really simple, and it made me think, oh yeah, why? So after that, I started for about 6 months really doing some thorough research into it. I realised with my whole being that it's true, it's a still fixed plane, and all the lies that followed and the implications of those lies really affected my life, because science looked down all the rabbit holes of where I've been lied to. For example, nobody went to the moon. NASA, it's just a company that's taken our lives off us, paying trillions of dollars for space projects that don't exist. The education system teaching people that all these things are possible when in fact it's all lies. Lots of things like that.
So where did that lead you then? Once your initial discovery, what path did it differentiate from your previous path?
It took me on a journey where I accepted that I was significant, just a bit like Jamie was saying before, and that the Earth's created, it's designed. So with that, it took me to the Bible. And in that book, and I think it's the only book that explains the Earth created that way, still fixed plane, on pillars, with a firmament, with a creator that sits above the circle of the Earth. So you actually do feel significant. You are created. You are not just by accident, by chance. So that brought a whole new world of
discovery.
Yeah, discovery. And took me on maybe what we call the Christian journey. And again, those lies and deceit held within that religious way. So you have to be really discerning, and it's really difficult because each path that you go on, each step that you take, there are more lies appearing. And you've got to go out yourself.
From gatherings like this in Manchester, where like minds get together, what are you taking from this and where do you see it going?
Oh, well, I absolutely love coming to things like this because of the depth of the knowledge that you can gain from other people, from everyday walks of life, so many different, you know, ages, beliefs, cultures and backgrounds all coming together for one massive cause. And that when we discuss things, and we have got like minds, so people have been truth seekers and they have gone down those rabbit holes and discovered, like someone said about pharmaceuticals or chemtrails, etc. The government, the lies, the education, the healthcare system. When you look down all these rabbit holes and see that our lives are literally being taken, it's good to get together with people, you know, to see what we might be able to do, to maybe help other people discover the truths, even though it's frightening and people don't like change. Without change, this world is going to fall into a really dark place, and it's not, the people are not going to be able to get out of it too late. So I pray for all these people today, and thank God that they show up, and I hope that this grows and gains strength in numbers, so that we can see the lies and the truth, and then be discerning about what we do then. So yeah, it's fab coming here because you feel like your spirit's lifted, you've got a warm heart, you don't feel like you're crazy, things get reflected back to you that you've been looking into. People are coming from their own different walks and paths, discovering new things as well on the journey. It's just really, really amazing.
Thanks, Janet.
Thank you.
The implications and effects. I was an atheist. I say I was an atheist. My dad died, I was about 18, 34 now. I didn't believe there was a God, I didn't believe it was created. And it just sort of opened my eyes to it, really, so that if we're the centre of the universe, everything revolves around us completely, then there's got to be a reason for everything. And then I looked at Fibonacci code and things like that, and it just opened my eyes to it. I was into spirituality first of all, I stopped drinking 4 years ago. After I stopped drinking, I got into world spirituality big time. And a friend of mine, like this time last year, was saying to me, Dan, the fact you're in spirituality, the world's flat, you're getting further. I'm like, no, I'm not having it. And he goes, just look at it. And one day, me and this friend had a slight argument, and it was because I was in the world's good time. No, everything's good, positive. And he had a bad day at work. I was like, no, don't bring it to me, something. Anyway, as we leave my house, he goes, Dan, get in the real world. And I was like, went to the shops, all kind of real world. And I believe so many things are happening with meditations and things like that. So I thought, something else is worth a look at anyway. And then, as I say, I just watched 200 Proofs. Well, I didn't watch it. I put it on and thought, I wasn't quite into it at first, so I put it on. I'm going to put it on, and I just went and did the washing up, I heard number 3. And I was like, what? I went and sat down at number 9, and then at number 50, I remember it like it was yesterday. It was, if the sun's 93 million miles away, then how can it heat on the Sahara Desert to 100 plus degrees? And then just up there, yonder there, the Arctic supposedly is freezing. I was like, my God, no way. So, literally, my God. And then I was like, do you know what? It was like 2 o'clock in the morning by this time, like as I've gone through all these thought processes. I live on the A6, just off the A6, Britain's longest road. So I was like, right, I've got to prove something to myself, rather than just take something that someone's worked for it. So I went out, I remember there was water pipe fitters on the A6. So I went out onto the A6, I went up to one of them, I said, yeah, mate, how are you? And he's like, all right. I said, just a bit of a mad question this, mate, bear with me. And he's like, yeah, go on. I said, how many miles of this stuff do you lay then, like, spraying the piping? He said, thousands upon thousands of miles. I went, right. I said, we live on a ball, don't we? We live on the Earth's a ball. He goes, yeah. I went, how do you account for the curvature when you're doing it? And he just went, I said, I know, I'm not trying to wind you up here, mate, but I've just got into something. And he goes, mate, we don't. He shouted over another guy, and his boss over, and his boss came over, and he said, how do we, because he didn't want to admit it, he didn't know. And he said, they must do it back at the, I said, mate, go for it, they must do it back at the place or whatever. The pipes come off there and they're laid level. And he went,
that's it.
Yeah, exactly, all the way. So I was just like that. I was like, no way. And then I thought, he's onto something here, do you know what I mean? Well, I was onto something, it was opening up to me. And then, so then I literally got myself at my spirit level from home the next day. And the next couple of days it was. I thought, how can I go and prove it to myself? That's what I thought. When we were younger, we used to climb up this massive, ridiculously large hill with Lion Park, it's called. It's got Lion Cage at the top of it. And you can see out to onto Manchester, parts of Liverpool and whatnot. So I thought, right, well, I can see the horizon from there. So I'll go up there and check that first of all, see the horizon is flat. Horizon met my eye level. I literally used the cage to hold my spirit level up and straight across, completely level. And I was blown away, to be honest with you. Obviously it's a world of conspiracy as well, so everything's been hidden. But for me, it's more what's been hidden, what can we do? What are we all capable of, really? Do you know what I mean? There's been how many billions of us have been on the earth, and there's only been one of me, there's only been one of you, yourself. Do you know what I mean? So everything starts to knit together, sort of way. Do you know what I mean?
Well, that would enhance your spiritual life as well, wouldn't it? And your spiritual beliefs.
Definitely.
And pre-flat earth, you just accepted everything that had been given to you with the indoctrination, but only when something else was offered and you can use your own brain and your own mind and your own senses, could you prove to yourself it's different than what you've been taught.
Yeah. That's the main thing, really, isn't it, really? You led down this path of, you're just a bit lucky, you're here, sort of thing. Whereas the flat earth brought me to realise that it's not luck. Do you know what I mean? It's not just a random access. Whereas, when you do you know, like the Big Bang Theory and things, because I did, before Flat Earth, I thought, I want to know about the world, and let's look at the theory of relativity. And even when I watched a couple of documentaries, went to read the book and everything, and I was just like, it just don't make sense. It's just, I don't care how smart you've got to be, you can do one. I'm not having it, because then when you read that, like, you know, only 3 or 4 people on the planet could have been tell you what the theory of relativity really was, and everything. Exactly, what use is it to you? And I just thought to myself, no, I'm gonna go off. I'm gonna program myself as well. That was the main thing that happened to me actually. Before I got into the Flat Earthers, really, was to get off the mainstream of the TV and everything. I had a really amazing experience with in spirituality, where I've been working at a taxi rank, and every day I'd be upstairs, a pizza shop guy would come in and he'd play old 90s music. Do you remember Gangster's Paradise?
Yeah.
He'd playing that living in Gangster's Paradise. And the girl got me that. I was 12 years old. She got me that on our first date. As a birthday present, she was saying, on our first date. And I thought to myself, do you know, Gemma, I was always good friends with her. I hope she's well, wherever she's on. I really do. Before I got into Flat Earth, there was a map on the wall. I knew she was in Australia. So I was like, wherever you are in Australia, I hope you're doing really well. Because I believe we're all connected, yeah? 2 weeks go by, and I was just getting on the phone. And he goes, do you know, you're on Facebook. I said, what? Why? I don't do Facebook. I didn't at the time. She said, oh, no, it's really nice. And it turned out Gemma Teagle was talking to a friend of mine. And she said, oh, how are you? He says, oh, I'm really well. She said, do you ever see out of Danny? Me? And he said, yeah, all the time. Yeah, he's been helping me recently. And she said, no way. Do you know, I've not spoken or heard of Danny Loftus in 10 years. But last week I was dreaming about him. And I tracked him down. And I phoned her up, got hold of her, and the minutes I was stood up there in England, cold old England, thinking of her on the other side of the earth, she was in Perth, she was asleep and dreamt about me.
Wow.
And then that was it. That was 4 years ago now. But I went that night and I found that out. I went and got a pair of pliers, cut out my aerial symbolically and threw it out the window. Cut the aerial to my television, threw it out the window, and just thought, no, I'm proving myself in that one. And then, and that's where it leads you to, you know, to happiness sometimes, really does. I'm not just saying that just, but
real happiness, not programmed happiness.
Yeah, what you're supposed to be happy about, do you know what I mean? And things like that. And then, well, really, I can't not mention the cannabis oils and things like that, really, because that was, I already knew when our biggest organ in our body is called your endocannabinoid system, the biggest collection of neurons are your CB1 receptors, your CB2 receptors throughout your body. So CB1 stands for cannabidiol receptor. You've got to this information.
It runs alongside the endocrine system.
Yes, it does do. It runs alongside the endocrine system. But at the same time, it's been our largest system inside our body. If we've got any problem in our bodies, first of all, we've got depletion in our cannabinoids. So we need to give it fresh cannabinoids and whatnot. So I'd already, I remember reading one somewhere, you see the world's conspiracy as a big tapestry. And you pull one part of it, you'll come to the truth in the end, if you know what I mean. And that was my starting point, I think, of my truth. And then just to come to foot.
And how is that not included in bio? So you've discovered that yourself. You know, you can ignore all the lies that find your entry. Coming to meetings like this may help you enhance everything that you know about.
So that's the main thing that I take from here is just because it's lonely at the start. Do you know what I mean? It is. I'm glad I had my friend Ben and that I could chat with, but because it's such a paradigm shift and it's so different to what everyone else believes from at the start, I'm not having it. And just last week, four of my friends, about 2 o'clock in the morning, to the library, and talked about it. I said, look, not being funny, but does the earth curve? He said, yes, it does, of course it does. I said, right, so there's got to be a mathematical formula for it to curve, isn't there? He said, well, yeah, of course there is. I said, I'll tell you what, let's just Google it quickly, what's the formula? And it came back with a load of jargon, and then at the end of it, 8 inches a mile, right? But it's not, it's actually the distance you see squared times 8 inches. But I said, tell you what, that's not even correct, right? We'll go from what Google say there, right? So, 2,800 miles, can you times that by 8 for me? I was like, why? Right, just said times that by 8. So he ties the by 8, right, which is a ridiculous amount of curving feet when you know, break it down. And I said, so how do we have a 2,800 square mile salt flat? If it's curved. We had it.
Do you know, that's a good point. It's a strong point. Do you know what I mean? But that's it. You've got to find it for yourself.
And this is what we see when people say you're not awake. This is it. The willingness to research things by yourself will be able to do. So anyway, Dan, thank you for that.
Oh, thank you.
So the first realization I remember was just this really strange, like, feeling of slowing down of time, like everything just kind of went shoo. And I just felt like there was just this stillness suddenly, and I was looking at the world as a completely different world, but also a familiar one at the same time. So I just felt like I was looking around me like, oh yeah, it's always been flat, it's always been still, but at the same time there's this feeling of time slowing down and coming to an end sort of thing.
When you realise the depth of the lies and the implications of the lies, what did that do to you? How did it make you feel?
At first it made me feel totally shaken, like I was like, I realised suddenly, because even though I'd been looking into other truths, and I wouldn't love to say conspiracy theory, but I've been truth seeking for a long time, looking into different things, I'd not so far like thought about it could possibly be, I mean, I knew it was possibly spiritual, but I didn't realise that there was anything people say Luciferian or satanic or anything like that. But when I realised that it was such a massive scale deception, then suddenly I realised that there could be, the Bible could be true and it could be biblical truths, and it kind of shook me a little bit, because I was yet to be a believer in the God of the Bible, you know. So
this journey of the flat earth took you on to another journey, to the God of the Bible, and then it started affecting Hacked on your
life. So for me there was no doubt that there's some kind of quickening of people using the flat earth to quicken them towards the awareness of a bigger spiritual force in life, or a creator, or the awareness of our purpose or meaning. And because there's so many people in this, you know, we're on the sort of Gregorian clock, the Gregorian calendar, and by the same rhythmic, the same patterns, the same rhythms, we all start work on a Monday, finish on a Friday, and that's obvious. But what wasn't obvious to me was that it came about by just one small group of men that kind of invented it, in the same way as they designed streets and they designed many other things, such as scientific concepts for us to digest. So, yeah.
So in a sense, it could sound like our lives have been taken off us, and we've been offered or given something else instead of what we should have had, which we have been.
Yeah, that's exactly what it felt like. I was already feeling like I didn't fit in this worldly pattern. So when I found out such a magnitudinal lie as the Earth is flat, on the one hand it made perfect sense somewhere intuitively, it made perfect sense, and on the other hand I was completely shocked, I felt untethered, I was bewildered, I almost went catatonic, because I didn't know all you guys by then. I was alone, well I knew you, but I was alone with a lot of the ideas. But there were other things culminating in my life as well. I knew I was under spiritual oppression due to false beliefs, and from a personal point of view, I was wanting change in my life, and nothing that I was looking into, researching, or any of the spiritual practice I was doing was bringing about that change, until I found out the earth was flat, and then I realised there was a creator, and that's when things really started to shift in my life. Yeah.
Amazing. Thank you, Kim.
You're very welcome. Yeah.
It was just like, it didn't change me inside, because I already know Jesus. So he's everything, knowing him is everything, as you know. So it was just a wonderful thing to find out, and a thing to realise it makes perfect sense. It's something that I just realised was the truth within just a few minutes of hearing about it on one of these videos. And yeah, it's flat, there's a dome on top. God's watching in on us to see what we're doing.
So discovering that, did you feel closer to God and were able to appreciate the creation?
Well, I already did that, so no, it was already there. Knowing Jesus in your heart, know, land being flat is a wonderful thing, because the fact that it is flat is if it goes, it could fall off. So just, it's all about already knowing him in your heart. For me, I know him since I was this high, so.
What about the Christians that might not know?
Well, they need to humble themselves and to receive this truth, because it is flat, and it's the only way you would ever design the land is to be flat, isn't it? And we know just through simple science that it can't be anything other than flat, so they need to just be humble and not be afraid of what people think about them.
Can you give us some examples of what you looked at to actually verify that it was flat and it was just
a bit? Well, when I clicked on the first video that said flat earth in the title, before I even clicked on it, I thought, I bet that's true. It just intuitively just made perfect sense, so I clicked on it. And within 3-4 minutes, I knew it was true. And this, the thing is, if gravity was real, obviously we'd just be crushed to death into the divine. If it can hold a 10-ton boulder with the same surface area as me, if it's pulling, see, the key word is, they say gravitational pull, the pull of the earth. Pulling forces must be felt, that's a law, and you don't feel them, therefore there is no pulling force. If I told you there's some water, I just dunked my hand in, and I pulled my hand out and it wasn't wet, you'd never believe that, would you? Water is wet, snow is cold, fire is hot, that's a law. So pulling forces are always felt, and you feel them. If a car pulls you, you'll feel it. If a rope pulls you, you'll feel it. If a penguin pulls you, you'll feel it. So if gravity was pulling you, you'd feel it, and then you'd be killed instantly, because the crushing force would be so immense.
And all the different variations of the pulling, like feathers and apples and things, and why aren't the fish looks like what we've seen. You know, it's so clever.
Well, you can define why things fall or rise in 10 seconds without using the word gravity, and you can't add to or take away from perfection and retain perfection. So if I can describe a law as to why things fall or rise up without using the word gravity or the concept of a pulling force, then gravity can't exist. And things just fall because they're heavier than the surrounding air they're displacing. And they float upwards because they're lighter than the surrounding air they're displacing. Exactly, it's the same in liquids. So we know that explains gravity, therefore there is no gravity.
So then that also suggests that what we observe with our senses is true.
Yeah, God's not playing a magic trick on us 24 hours a day with a magical spinning, rotating sphere that breaks all common sense and laws of logistics and physics 24 hours a day. That's not happening. So it is as you would design it. Me and you, if we were designing a city, we wouldn't design it as a ball and think, I know, I'll invent some magical thing that has about 1,000 things that don't make sense, but I'll just do it anyway. No, we just design flat land, we design it on pillars, and we design a roof on top. So that's how God made it. Exactly what the Bible says, He made the firmament. He hath made the sky firm, like unto molten glass, it says in the Bible. So if you were to go up and up and up eventually, you'd hit something firm. So we're under a dome, on pillars, on a flat plane.
What about any people that are not Christians? Do you have anything to say to those people about this?
About flat earth specifically, I'll just show them all the videos, all the proofs that you need, you know, Eric DeBay's videos, all the videos like that, that just explain it very concisely, very, you know, as to why it has to be this way, and why you can see things that you shouldn't be able to see. But mainly I just tell them that God loves them, and, you know, to repent of your sins while there's still time. He loves you so much, and he'll come into your heart. If you want him, he'll come into your heart.
Thank you.
The biggest change
is that I've not been saved and I believe in God. Really, it's the main thing.
Can you take us on a little journey from the beginning up to that point?
Yeah, okay, so like 2012 I got really ill. Lost 2 ounces of stone in like 3 days. My ears started ringing, my legs started locking up. Lots of things I can't remember now. I couldn't wait, give me the time to look into things. And I looked into everything. You know, all the conspiracy. Well, started off with pharmaceutical stuff because of how I got treated when I was ill and stuff like that. You know, led on to look into everything else. The flat earth one was something that I didn't, you know, stayed away from for a bit, but when I did look into it, I realised that it was true. The biggest thing for me was water. I always find it as that. That was like, I didn't really need all these technical this, that and the other. It was water finding its own level. The earth's flat. That was it. So I realised that it was flat, that it was created. And started reading the Bible, Bible verses. You know, when I'm reading the Bible, it tells me the earth's flat, all these different verses.
Well, it appears that a lot of people have gone to the Bible because of how the earth is described in Genesis. Mm-hmm. People are running to that verse, and then maybe God's saving them somewhere. Mm-hmm. The but before that happened, because you maybe were choosing to use the films themselves, when the implications of the lies came, how did that affect you?
It just like kind of destroyed myself. So at that time, I was trying to tell all my friends and family all about it, and they just thought it was nuts. So it was really hard for a few years my life was hard and lonely. But now, I do have to say that now, not just the flat earth, but all these different conspiracies, friends and family do see it, but they don't want to do anything about it. So it's good in a way.
So your friends and your family, they may have maybe accepted it might be true about the flat earth, but they won't look into it, and they haven't found God.
That's true.
So coming to meetings like this, that's going to help to do.
For me, it just lifts your spirit. Especially, a lot of people are sat at home researching hours and hours, and you're on your own, aren't you? So coming to something like this, even if everybody's not on exactly the same page, it lifts my spirit.
You feel like you're connecting with people.
Yeah.
You're not insane after all. Some of the conversation content is scientific.
Yeah.
There's all kinds of different people who come to these meetings. Would you encourage people who don't know about it, who've heard about it, or who know a lot about it, to come to these meetings?
I would absolutely encourage anybody to come, even if you're unsure. There's nobody here who's going to judge you in any way or anything like that, or laugh at you or say you're nuts. You know, good friendly people. So serious without that, that edge.
So overall, that earth experience has been a positive one for you, but it may not start off like that.
Yeah, positive. But now, especially since it's just gone positive since I've met other people. Because you realise you're not on your own, you're not nuts, you're not this, that, you're not that.
Can I just ask you as well then about your health? How has that improved as well? Has something happened that's contributed to the improvement of your health?
Oh, yeah. Since all of this, my health is so much better. It's not, I can't say it's 100% right, but I know that. I believe that. I got ill so I could come. There's a reason for it. A lot happier, a lot fitter, a lot healthier.
Make
get yourself to a flat earth meeting.
Yeah. Thank you, Jamie. Thank you for putting these meetings on. Really good, really beneficial. Where do you see these meetings going? Have you got a view for a bigger picture of where you'd like to take them?
I think when I see them grow and develop into we're getting a lot more people coming united over common interests, conspiracies, and alternative views and things. Maybe people who are a bit more influential might kind of start sort of recognizing that, and they'll start to sort of try and promote what we do, and kind of we can sort of work the masses up.
So it doesn't matter, it's not just about the flat earth, it's about anything that you might be uncertain about that's going on in the world. To come and meet like-minded people, and you can share.
Meet people who question reality, our very existence, because we don't agree with the official narrative that's been sort of that we've been told programmed into believing that, all these different things.
So when did you first discover, not just the flat earth, when did this journey for you about the lies start, when did you first become aware of that knowledge, certain things in the world, and what implications have it had on your life?
Well, first kind of, I think it was around, oh, 2015 when somebody kind of got me onto the chemtrails, but you know, I kind of looked into that stuff and
what is that?
Chemtrails, it's the trails of, you know, that the airplanes that leave these trails, and some of those are thinking that they're, you know, intentionally trying to spray us with chemicals for whatever reason, and that, so I kind of, well, I was already kind of awake to like the government corruption and stuff like that, but I kind of weren't really surprised that they would be able to do something like that. And then I just came across other things like the Mandela effect, the North Forest and Flat Earth, and then kind of, so I started to sort of look deeper and think, well, you know, is this Earth even actually a globe, like, telling us? So I just, in around sort of August 2016, I kind of just started to kind of research the flat earth. I mean, I was kind of open because I knew there was corruption in the world, lies. So I kind of had to sort of look into that, and I kind of realised that there's something really wrong with this spinning globe earth model that we've been taught as children.
So why would you lie about
that? I think that they lie because they want to make us feel like that we're just an insignificant speck of dust, because if the universe is ever expanding, it's, some will say it goes on forever, there's multiverses and stuff like that, then our significance diminishes, and that gives them a kind of ability to have a massive amount of control over us, because they know something that we don't.
Who are they?
Well, they are people that run the people that rule, people that are in control. We can't know who they are because they try to sort of not have themselves known, so what they'll do is they'll hide behind labels like Jews and Freemasons, Illuminati,
government.
Yeah, all these different labels, because they don't want themselves to be known, because they have all these secret societies, that they have all secret agendas that they want to try and sort of force on people, and we don't really know who they are exactly, but we know that there's these people with not good intentions, because if you get to a high position of power, you have to sell out, because you have to step on toes to get to that position.
So they've like sold their soul to get them, in a sense. You can't be in that club without doing something.
Yeah, they have to like, they have to sell out to be able to sort of get like some of these big celebrities, some big people. They have to sort of sign a contract, which basically allowing them to kind of do what they want, basically.
So by coming along to these meetings, not only can you meet up with like-minded people, but we can also maybe get some of the answers that haven't been answered, like what chemtrails are, what they do and what they're for. because other people yeah, might yeah, a little bit more, not a bit more research,
insight, and things like that.
Insight, yeah. So it's well worth coming to these meetings. So thanks again, Jamie. I'm going to ask you one thing. Do you think the Earth is flat?
It's flat as a witch's tits. What?